Changes three. When I have the 8 and 9, I want to insert 2 phrases so the sentence would read, during the discussion, council waived his rules to allow Mr. Greg Reinke, Mr. David Stanton to speak. Mr. Reinke, a downtown businessman, said that he has secured over 7,000 in pledges from downtown merchants and citizens. And line 68, insert after sales tax to the city, insert the state eliminated if we this year.
I'm Lisa Ogren. I'm the chairman of the library board. On behalf of the board, I'd like to thank council for its continued support of the library and its programs. The library sees more people one-to-one in a positive way annually than any other department in the city. As a result of the programs that council has supported, there's an average of 2 people per minute through the doors all year long. Since the year 2000, material circulation has increased 63.9%, while the staff has increased by 2 part-time people. There's a class community with outstanding leadership. They love what they do, and they have fun while continuing to provide exemplary service to the public. We appreciate the current economic challenges, but it's worthy to keep this funding at its current levels.
Thank you, Lisa. Jimmy Braley?
My name is Jimmy Braley. I work as an intern at the Willis Meeting Event and Tradition Initiative in the Venus Library. I don't want to take up too much of your time, but I want to kind of make note of my experience there in the short time that I've been there in the past month. I've been volunteering there for barely over a month, but in that time I've had the privilege of seeing firsthand how community can come together, not only for individuals, but really for every member of that community as a whole. My experience thus far has been in a world very humbling. I've lived in Middle Street for about 10 years now. One of the best parts of living in this community is the fact that any one of us can walk down the street and see any number of different people from any number of different backgrounds from any corner of the globe. The diversity here is amazing. The most exciting part about all of that, though, is how people in Littleton can come together to produce an environment where everybody is able to live effectively, where people are able to find the right services for anybody from any background. I agree with receiving $50,000 in grant money, as I'm sure most of you probably know. Because of the way that it's been able to set an example nationwide of a proactive rather than simply reactive or inactive response to immigration. And it's obviously in this country that's not going to advance if it's either nor. Just the other day, I met the Ethiopia community. We got a food stamp card, but it wasn't working. And he wasn't able to buy groceries, and he, like a number of immigrants that we work with, are sleeping on the floor of a relative's apartment with their children and their wives, or their husbands. So he wasn't able to buy groceries, he wasn't able to buy clothing, he wasn't able to buy anything like that. And when he came into the office, I had only been officially working there for 2 days. I gave him enough resources for him to go out and get involved in programs that could help him with that kind of thing. And when he left, he told me that the month and a half that he had been in this country, that I was able to help him more than any other person since he got here in this country. On the one hand, it's very humbling, and it's really, really good to hear that my work. But on the other hand, it's kind of ridiculous, that somebody like me in my position having been officially working there for 2 days to help him out that much. One of the things that L.L. Drew is really good about is treating people like they're human beings. And Littleton has been not recognized nationally for that fact, for taking a proactive stance on immigration. And I just wanted to hope the council keeps this organization in mind, its impact on the community, and its impact on the immigrants in the community particularly. Thank you.
Thank you, Jay. And from the platform, the city, thank you for your volunteer work and for the folks in the immigrant agency. We have something like 170 some active volunteers, and we're very grateful for all of them because that's when it's the initiative work. Okay, anybody else?
Okay. I'd like to bring up a question about the normal experience is that certain of the doctors have a number of bridges that we're crossing from North China. The council has expanded one by the high school, the Ivy Mountain, I'm going to request that funding for another bridge next year to come from the apartment area on the south side of the street, which is an action trail on the north side. Some of the parking that is pushing here is in the farm. So we don't know the fact that this year is not being done on time. Okay. And the request is for $90,000.
Right, and there's the standard public appearances that we don't have any, or unscheduled public appearances, which is where anyone can come down and address some any topic, get an opinion, ask a question, staff can limit us up to about 4 minutes, and get your name and address.
Or just serve as personnel for the overlooked fire station to answer the door. That would not have been put into a stressful situation to cause my trust fees. I do not believe, and that was presented to my insurance company, I do not believe that Anthem or myself is shoulder the full responsibility of giving $1,185 to our sponsor city of Littleton, UMass. Why should we be responsible for the failure of the 911 system or the failure of the city of Littleton to properly staff their fire station or rescue station? My granddaughter could have died from her seizure or a serious automobile accident, or I could have had a heart attack, died from a heart attack or a serious automobile accident. This would suggest my granddaughter was taken to the Littleton address hospital. She was in seizure mode for approximately 40 minutes, and they were going to incubator at that time, but again, and it was very unusual about her seizure to the least in the last 3 to 5 minutes. So, my main complaint is that, okay, if you're not going to properly manage your station and put a sign after, please don't pay in people who don't have help to take care of you. So,
Those people that are letter to the city manager, we will get back with you with a response on the $985. It's also good that you bring this up because it's probably a reasonable expectation that people would think that if you went to the fire station now, there's nobody there. And I don't believe that we staff the fire station, there's a few people there at the station. It could be that everybody's gone on a call, although you bring out a good point that you probably ought to probably find that and let people know. But, that's probably not the right place to go. I think we need to check the 911 records and see what's happening at that particular place. Thank you for coming down.
Thank you, Lee. I have a copy of that. Thank you.
Anybody else? Okay. That brings us to the consent agenda. The primary items that are non-controversial and then can be adopted by a simple motion, all ordinances and regulations must be read in title. The first is an ordinance, in first reading, amending City Code Section 1171B1 pertaining to parking open space. You can read that by title, please.
This is an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Littleton, Colorado, amending City Code Section 11-7-1B1 pertaining to parks and open space fees, also applied to senior living facilities, and City Code Section 11-7-2A relating to the use of the fees.
Okay, I'm going to pull that to the end to put the reading date. So, I don't know what the most says on it. Second item is an ordinance on first reading amending sections 671 and 679 of the Littleton City Code pertaining to weapons.
This is an ordinance of the City of Littleton, Colorado, amending Title 6, Chapter 7 of the City of Littleton Municipal Code pertaining to weapons.
I'm going to refer back to the specified date for the second reading.
Thank you. Okay. Mm-hmm.
Item 7C. Again, it's a book reading granting a conservation easement for the golf property between the City of Littleton and South Natural Land Conservancy.
This is an ordinance of the City of Littleton, Colorado, approving a conservation easement between the City of Littleton and South Natural Land Conservancy for the Lee Golf property acquisition.
This is a book reading, second reading, which is scheduled for June 16th. We're purchasing a piece of property along Lee Gulch with the Broadway, Gecko Santa Fe. Sorry, Santa Fe. Gecko is probably $750,000 in the purchase price. They require a conservation easement to protect the use of the property. This is changing the conservation easement to South Metro Land Conservancy. And as I said, the second reading on that would be used to
speak.
Item 7D is an ordinance on first reading and acting section 9-1-12 of the Littleton City Code pertaining to red light cameras for signalized intersections. So you can read that by title.
This is an ordinance of the City of Littleton, Colorado, enacting Section 1-12 of Title IX, Chapter 1 of the City Traffic Code pertaining to the use of red light cameras at signalized intersections to detect violations in Section 603 of the Model Traffic Code for Colorado. Someone to hold it.
All right, thanks, Cole. Item 7E. Is an ordinance of changing the meaning of sheriff's tax code sections 3-9-3-5 and 3-9-3-6. You can read that by title, please.
This is an ordinance of the City of Littleton, Colorado, amending Title 3, Chapter 6 of the Littleton City Code to limit the vendor credit of 2.5% to the lesser of 2.5% or $100.
Here this is second reading of Chapter 7th, and this is for the maximum amount of $100 that you would pay as a fee for booking to collecting sales tax. 7F. So, with the list including an intergovernmental agreement with Raffle County regarding the resolution in the Urban County Community Development Block Grant Program.
This is a resolution of the City Council of the City of Littleton, Colorado, approving the intergovernmental agreement with Arapahoe County relating to the Community Development Block Grant and Home Investment Partnership Program.
This is for the years 2010 to 2012. The language in the agreement has been updated to contain or remove language that the Housing and Urban Development Department was concerned about. Some language that counties had issues with, and it would incorporate language that appeared with the pending amendments.
I'll pull that.
Okay. And this brings us to 7G, which is a resolution for approving an intergovernmental agreement with the Raffle County for Open Space Center.
This is the resolution of the City of City Council of the City of Littleton, Colorado, approving the intergovernmental agreement with Arapahoe County relating to the contribution of county open space program funds to the Lead Bulk acquisition.
This is what Jim Taylor was referring to earlier. I'm sorry, this is set later on. This is related to the conservation easement with the land we have. The county is going to contribute $105,000 towards this. They're going to fund an escrow account, which will be held by a title company. There's another paperwork that's included in the closing happen. And this is approved in an government agreement for obtaining that funding. So I believe that leaves two items, E and G on the consent agenda. I move we approve the consent agenda items. 7E and 7G.
Second.
Okay, so move. And second is the first consent agenda item 7E and G. The motion is approved. Back to 7A, I believe it is. And I pulled that because I wanted to change the second reading dates for July 7th because Councilman Austin will not be here on the 16th and there's no real urgency on this. So I move that the ordinance amended the City Code Section 11-7-1B1 pertaining to parks and open space fees as they apply to senior living facilities and City Code Section 11-7-2A relating to the use of the fees. Okay, first on first reading, the public hearing date is set for July 7th. July 9th, and the ordinance to be published by posting at the Littleton Center, Games Library, and the Municipal Courthouse, and on the Littleton City of Littleton website.
Thank
you. Okay, so moved and seconded to approve by first reading those amendments. Any discussion? Vote 7-3, the motion approved. 7B is an item that I pulled because the motion doesn't set a second reading date that we need to do. So I move with the ordinance amending section 6-7-1 and 6-7-9 of the agency code to include the statutory affirmative defense to carry certain weapons to approve appropriate in separate public hearing on July 7th.
2009. Will second.
Second.
Okay,
I'm hoping that City Attorney would briefly tell us what this covers, because I talked by email on this the state statute when we try to read that in version here, there, and everywhere. And our attorney said to me, you don't want to make it more precise to think by reference. Because if it changes their code, then we won't keep having the same eyes. So that will at least like prepare the reason for us in the reading public to hear what this allows and doesn't allow in this instance.
Okay, right before you do that, I had neglected to lay this open for discussion as we move to second to approve the ordinance and then do sections 6-7-1 and 6-7-9 of the local city code. And who's statutory from you to thank the attorney certain way?
Yeah. I'm going to call Suzanne Fett, but I just think that it's just this issue. So, what do you think that we need to see, Susan? 6-7-1 talks about being able to take the violations, and it's simple to conceal offensive weapons that we were addressing as affirmative defenses in Title 18, and I scattered throughout, but generally they are, it could potentially be a factual defense, which is why we wanted to weapons in that code. There are certain activities such as hunting, struggling with a concealed weapon in your vehicle, or being at home. Would be protected activity, but it would not violate those sections. And then 6-7-9, which talks about bringing weapons on public property, if you have a valid permit to carry, you would not be in violation of that provision of that code. So, it was pretty simple, right? It was pretty simple, but we anticipate that there's going to be, features and additional changes in the data protections to conceal carry laws, and so with that in mind, we didn't want to specify because in anticipation of anything that we can amend the ordinance again soon.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Discussion? The motion is to approve on first reading, amended sections 671 and 679. The board is having a fair motion approved. Looking at item 7C, with the ordinance approving the conservation easement for legal property between the city of Milton and South Central Avenue. Who pulled that? Is it you did?
I pulled it because of a couple of things in the agreement that I wanted to discuss or fix, that it's a little clarity understanding why the needs be included in the grant. And then, depending on what I would feel about that, I want to try to move it from the house before we go to do something. Moving on this. I'm concerned that is on page 5 of that theme, where some of the included minor structures would be an open table. Just my one concern, and then a little explanation on what, quote, other minor structures reasonably appropriate for environmental education, maybe to the property or to facility, just pass it back over to the countries.
And then also with the Tom Canfield, who is the staff director of the MP Overview, and
Bobby, would you have information that was the grantee of the easement? And this happened as the grant of conservation easement from the city of Littleton on the property we would own at the legal open space to the staff natural conservancy. And it was perpetual. It was actually required in order to get the GoCo money. And doing this is a lead into the questions for the council person Brinkman as well. GoCo is putting $750,000 into this acquisition. In order to do that, you have to have a conservation easement. Now, the particular details relating to the Brinkman table, for example, the system include is not to include a picnic shelter. It will only be a single physical picnic table that could be installed on the property in order for people who would be using the property to have a place to take a break. Typically, what you might see in natural open space areas that are manifest as suburban and over agricultural locations. There's no intention here is to allow for a shelter or any other kind of active area around that picnic table.
Let me just interject you. We're talking on a brilliant comment on the position of the project that she's worked hard on. And we know we need to get language in here to make council comfortable, but I want to remind you if you don't necessarily. I don't think we can be necessarily concerned that the words may fit perfectly due to the fact that you still have to approve a master plan on the property. So any specificity down the road would still have to come back to you, and you still have to go to the board. So I just want to make sure you understand that.
I think what you're trying to say is that if it's allowed in here, it can be done. And then the second point to raise, Councilman Benton, has to do with appropriate for environmental education, maintenance of property, or so forth. What was added here is the potential on the property to maybe put a display beside that might indicate what you are doing when looking to the west. On the west part of this land, there's a tremendous view of the South Platte River Valley and the mountains. And we're past a navy an educational panel or illustrated type of map could be placed on the property to indicate where you are in relationship to the South Platte River Trail, what happened at the South Platte River in a previous film, maybe historical information. That was the type of educational material that could be placed there. There was never an intent to try and describe this as a school facility or a place where people might gather. There are other places around the South Pole River that would be appropriate. I would like Bobby or Hillary to address these points too if they have something more to say.
Okay.
Okay. Before that sentence, which is where I got my concerns, it was stated informational kiosks and interpretive signs, which I would assume would cover what you were talking about. What I'm concerned about on the other verbiage there is things like fed, things like porta potty, things like, what facilitates talk about the recreational activities that would be the structure. I'm not having a worse interest in the fact that in the world, there's a concern about this, but you get a little bit of a stir up
One that I'd like to deal with tonight more specifically, and that is the page 5, number F. Some security lighting is necessary, blah, blah, blah. There's a parking lot back there, and I believe there is some lighting, or would not be working at this point, but certainly could. I have a huge issue with this, because our parking lot these days, and particularly that area along the river there, is closed from dusk dawn. So there should be no need for lighting. I really discourage and do not support any lighting on that property whatsoever. It is completely contrary to what we're trying to do with this. And there is, in fact, some very precious bird nesting going on over there right now, and that kind of lighting will absolutely destroy what is happening over there. So, I'd like to
we built parcels that are being acquired. The front part is being done by the same building. It's about 8 cents an acre. We're acquiring the back side of about 8 acres. The parking lot that you refer to is on the same parcel owned by South Suburban. There is a lake there right now. And I'm not sure it's operational at this moment, but it probably needs some maintenance. The intent was to provide a light at the parking lot, which this intersection of urban keep that parking lot there, although again, we will have authority over that through the master planning process. If the parking to remove this paragraph from here, we could do it now or at the second meeting or after South Metro. And the building and ask for their comments that you wish to make.
I'd like to make a suggestion and I think it would be more productive if we hear the concerns tonight and then if we have instructions from council to go back and maybe start the negotiation process now rather than waiting for the public hearing. If it's possible, we would just kind of maybe zoom on the process a little bit.
Yes.
But the security lighting, if they put more security in front of them, they did good way of kind of lighting like that. There is some things that are going on any of that right now. I'm not certain about small planning and how to do that yet, but, I think lighting lights, people, I don't think it sends the message that the place is closed, and so I think I'm grasping for the same community problems with the map, which I like to, that's something that we can figure out before we go further on that.
And after you wrote in that question, also, Councilwoman, I think maybe you'd want to look at some of our other trailheads. I'm just trying to think of other places where we have trailheads, whether we have security lighting. I know we certainly are along the highlands now. I'm thinking in general where we have security lighting, but we may want to have the police department take a look at this too, just in terms of,
we have central location on the east of that. We put that in the council communication next time. If there's a desire of council to direct us to try to remove this section, we can move forward with that and represent it to you on the second meeting, if that's the feeling of the council.
Well, what I suggest procedure is we don't have a motion on the floor. We need a motion before we start discussing what we're saying. I would suggest we finish the questions and we need a motion to approve this. And we direct staff to bring up comments back from South Suburban, for instance, in the police department and the lawyer. I don't know if you want comments on the different table on environmental structures. And then you can also try and make an amendment. Motion to amend this and for free if you still want to do that.
Right.
So we need to get the motion first, but let's finish the question. Sorry, are you done?
No.
Okay.
Sorry. I'm going to try to ask the meeting. Number one, fourth line from the bottom, it says it is the intent of the grantor to maintain the property as primarily open space. Is there a reason for the word primarily in there? I mean, it's open space.
Page four?
Yeah. Page four, number one.
It's a trail based on the property, and might connect with a new gulch trail.
You've got a parking lot, it's not open space.
The primary function of acquiring the property is open space. So, parking lot. Parking lot, actually, on the South Suburban portion of the property. Maybe some of it, part of it is on our property. So, there is part of the parking lot on the city property, yes.
That's just shows all the parking lot is on our
property.
The parking lot, according to the zoning, parking lot's been qualified as open space.
Okay, well, that's a complimentary sentence.
The parking area that is currently listed on the back circle, on the back map, is certainly the area if you ever needed additional parking. This is the change in the parking use on the front parcel, change the current parking area. It provides the money. Yes, that's not the current parking area, and that's not necessarily intended to become an additional parking area. That is simply the area that if you ever did need to have additional parking on the property, that would be the location.
Okay, thank you. Okay,
if you look at the map on the back side, the legal trail on the north, there may be a way of finding a trail onto this property.
It says here, identify the board and Arapahoe County grants and investments in this property to the public. I'd like to see a little bit more on that. Yeah.
Okay.
And I'll put that in a motion. I don't know if that's number seven. Could you please give me an example?
Referring to the first sentence, the number seven?
Yeah, I mean, what would an example of what?
I guess when we prefer the master plan, that would be a way of describing what activities could occur on the property and giving the South Metro Land Conservancy all possibilities to comment and review and inform.
It wouldn't be mowing, it wouldn't be barding, it wouldn't be...
Well, mowing would be part of the maintenance activity.
Right, so you don't need to use this notice for that.
There was no intent that this would be a location that private parties could develop.
Would it be if there was going to be some sort of major, if there needed to be some...
The responsibility for managing the property is in our hands, the grantor. And performance with the conditions of the conservation easement monitored by the grantee. So I don't think South Metro Land Conservancy is responsible for preserving and protecting the conservation values as much as the city also is responsible.
But what is going through my head is, if we grant the right to do this, that doesn't mean they have to follow through unless they have a responsibility to be able to see. Not that they would have total responsibility.
To your point, I think actually both parties have the responsibility, not just the grant you and the grantor.
Yeah.
Both parties would.
Not even here.
The property is your job is to manage the mortgages in order to conform with the terms of the conservation easement. I have to go back to the first page, which is typical where you get the recitals under conservation purposes, and they learn that in reality it is the job of the grantor and the grantee that are described in the recital. The grantor is the sole owner, and then it further describes the grantee. Indeed, the whole open space and the preserved historical land and stuff. You don't need the recitals, but it has the purpose of what you're trying to accomplish between the grantor and the grantee. And I'm not sure you want separate land conservancy being responsible for preserving the open space as much as the city would be. They kind of monitor our responsible action. That's about what happens to me. Now, there are two ways to report this. One is through the master plan approval by the council and the board of South Suburban, and South Metro Land Conservancy being involved in the drafting of that master plan, and then secondly, how it is all managed so that it's not overtaken and moved, for example, or that the staff is picked up and people are there, or if there are people who have decided to camp on the property illegally. Both of it, management. I think there is a responsibility of the city and South Suburban to take care of that, and let the land conservancy to tell us we are not complying with the terms of the easement, sure enough. I'm giving you more words than the private said, but it's better than heard. So I'm going to do all those issues, but if you want more, we can address that too.
I'm going to take it a little. It seems to me that it doesn't quite catch the whole piece that we're trying to get at.
Sure. If you want to tighten that up in some way, you can, you know, if you want to thank the motion when you do that, it's a great time to address that.
Any other questions? For example, I'm going to suggest that we make a motion to approve it as is, and then if people want to amend it, if you make those as a motion to amend it. Otherwise, we're going to make a motion to approve it with amendments, and it may be voted down because we can disagree with the amendments. So we do not really do it as a motion to approve the whole thing and go back to amendments.
I will move to the Rogers Planning and Conservation Easement Video Research and Assistant Legal to approve on first reading, subject to public hearing on June 16, 2009. And published by Cook to the Board of Consumer Business Island of New York Courthouse. Please see what he has.
Second. Okay. The second has been moved and seconded to approve the ordinance on first reading granted a conservation easement on the open space properties raising the legal trail. Now, before we get into the amendments, I think it may be worthwhile having a discussion about the whole property. Part of what I think we're getting into the debate here is what the definition of open space is. And it appears that we have a rather wide range of opinions on what constitutes open space or not. I personally come down on if it has bluegrass and hay fields on it, it's a park. If it doesn't, it's open space. And I view this as an addition to South Platte Park that would then be managed along with South Platte Park and the park as a whole, rather than carving out this piece
and we're going to have the same process potentially with Denver and with the Murray property, rather than carving out those individual pieces and trying to study that in advance, first to happen on those pieces. I think it's better to put those into the park and allow that to happen as part of the master plan, because the master plan in theory is managing the entire park. So I'm a little reticent personally to start tweaking for fine detail what language you're going to put in here to restrict what the master plan can do with the property, because then you've got that park as a whole. This is not Ignatius South Plant Park. So I don't know how you're going to attack it to South Plant Park, which was created by the U.S. Congress. So I don't know how we can attach this property to the park that's not even close.
Well, if you want to just go through everything that goes up and down the river, down the mountain trail, on it to the South Plant Park. And I realize that we would put things in the master plan and put other things that are better to the park, but my guess would be most people that go up and down the trail and use the park have a hard time differentiating where the park boundaries begin and where the add-on properties that are adjacent to the property that are adjacent to the park. And that's true that there's different legal ramifications on different parcels. I'm really concerned that, let's say, a year from now, we acquire Santa Fe City of that. This whole master plan may change.
So that means a lot of reason.
Well, it may change for the better.
I will be here at night.
Okay.
And so, Councilmember Brinkman, that's why we were trying to get your comments out because if you bring them out at the next date, then we really don't have time to go back and negotiate them and bring it back to you again. So, if we could get direction tonight, that's preferable. We'd like to. I think we're going to make the conservation easement more restrictive. I don't think we're going to get an objection to that. But as a procedural matter, we have to have council approve it in the form in which it's put in front of you. And so whatever you'd like to see in it, we'd like to know now so we can make those changes going forward.
Since I won't be here, I'm just seeing if I can make one more comment as far as the parking at the South Platte Park. Look at the South Platte Park, right pay for half the maintenance. If we leave an open space on its own, that's the burden has to take care of. So you want to get in, you have 2 million to take care of it, maintain it, and all that. Plus, I don't know how you're going to attach it. Remember, South Bourbon pays 100% of the maintenance on open pay. We pay 50% of the maintenance in South Platte Park. Very good point. Hopefully, that's not part of the cost of the maintenance. But it's neither is the fact that it's South Platte Park.
Yeah.
So, if you're going to go there, just remember the argument.
The problem is not the good one.
Okay.
Suzanne, based on the
I think if you would like to do that, we'll have your intention at the next meeting. We would prefer to see you do that here so that we'll know whether we have direction to go and make those amendments. Otherwise, we'll have to have some sort of other meeting or if we can
have it. We have to have another meeting if we make the changes on this.
Well, we need to make sure that they are approved then by the conservancy. It has to go back to GOCO. So, potentially we would have somebody say, we don't like X, and then have to come back to council before the 30th.
Do you think the legal entities are going to be concerned about the types of language changes that the proposal is for all more restrictive rather than less restrictive?
Probably not with Council Member Brinkman. I think with Council Member Cole, where they may be concerned about having the court responsibility as to whether that would give a third party then a right to come in and say, you didn't uphold your responsibility. Right now it's just a right that they hold to enforce the easement, and if it becomes their responsibility to enforce the easement, that has a different legal effect. So I could see some comments on that.
So since you've commented on that, do you think the way it's worded now is okay?
I think it's fine. I just think if it were me and I were reviewing it and somebody were giving me the responsibility, then to me that means that they've created a legal obligation upon me. Not just the right to do something, but more of an obligation, may give rise to a third party being able to come in and say, I didn't fulfill my obligation. So that's really the only one that I hear that maybe might have to
do. I can do that. I need to ask that question so we could get that out there.
Yeah, I think to anybody hearing it, that's the intent of it, but it has a specific legal implication that they may have comments on. So in short, if we were to say with Council Member Brinkman is more restrictive, I don't think we're going to have any problems getting somebody to say, sure, we'll make it more restrictive for you, but if we give them more goodies, then that may.
Do you want to try yours as an amendment, or do you want
to? No, I think, it sounds like it's better than what it is, legally and otherwise. And that's going to cause issues.
Okay.
The only amendment that I would like to make would be to amend page 7, L, the manager billboards, to identify the city of Olson. Because I think that would be one that other entities might want to look.
Yeah. 7.
Can you go over the building?
7, yeah, I was talking to the airport.
Yeah, this doesn't restrict Littleton's opportunity to put a star in F. These are actually requirements of the board and the Rockwell County funding. So the only reason that this is included in here is not to restrict what the sign says. It's that it's an obligation for Littleton because of these funds to include Boco and the Rockwell County on any kind of that. The three of Littleton can already include themselves as part of this fund. We will consider responsibility for the fund there.
Your problem is that there won't be a sign with this program on that, and there's no
problem. No, absolutely not. It's just that anyone who put up needs to acknowledge them because of their funding contribution.
Okay, so that's an amendment.
I suppose they can easily get to the sign to acknowledge it because of their contribution to this.
I'm dropping in it. Wait a second.
Okay. This leads us to the new motion. Is approving the first reading of a granting of an easement on City of Open Space property to the legal and set the public hearing to be in further discussion. That's ready to vote.
And the vote is done in favor of the motion to approve.
Maybe I'll raise the consent agenda. Here's item 7D, which is focus on first reading pertaining to red light cameras and signaling at the intersection.
I'll hold that one.
Okay.
I have a concern about this, because council is supposed to get the content on this. According to our minutes of January 20th, and we never seen a contract that relates to this. And I talked with Mr. Woods this afternoon about this, and if you might like to comment on that.
I will. I've discussed it also with Suzanne. And I thought, actually, I had Linda go and pull those minutes for me. And I just think we can go over these, and it's kind of council's discussion, but this is in the middle, this is from the January 20th meeting. There was a chief program, and the commanders were here, and there was quite a bit of discussion. Different council people expressed that this was something for Hero, and Councilman Melvin expressed a lot of support for the project going to be going. Got called up some questions about whether some revenue could be moved around. So there was a discussion about whether there could be some other input to the contract. And then Mayor Clark stated that it would be a waste of time for the police department to return for a third time and wanted to know exactly what council was authorizing. And then Suzanne stated that the issue will need to be returned to council for approval of the ordinance and the contract. As Dr. Cole pointed out, then there's some other discussion within the motion made by Mayor Clark. Says that staff is authorized to negotiate a contract with ATS to move forward to initiate the red light technology enforcement. So,
but the motion occurred before the statement that this would be returned to us. And the motion occurred after
the state of the motion, and you were going. Well, I just done meditation. Did I make that motion?
You didn't even go against me.
You didn't go against me. I had a problem in hearing you on. And Commander Brand are here. I guess, quite frankly, staff thought that we had authorization to go ahead, negotiate the contract. We knew we had to come back to the ordinance, but, you know, if council wants to see the contract, if you want to link it to it, obviously, you still have a final say so because you have to approve the ordinance before it can be implemented. So, fairly happy with the fog in the cracks. This was a little fuzzy, so we don't have to look close to come back to it. Now we can certainly send you the contract. You can look at it.
Do you have a contract?
Yeah.
Yes.
And can I suggest that you include this in the packet for the second reading of the ordinance? Would that be sufficient?
Yeah, that's fine with me. And the motion did, we took the vote after the statement that the contract would come back to us with the ordinance. My recollection of the discussion was just that there were some kinds of people concerned about what the provisions of the contract were going to be, and then there was some discussion about whether there was a percentage for the company and things like that. And it was my recollection that council at one point had said they wanted to see the contract. And so I think I was initiating what council had intended they wanted to see, whether that was then sort of pushed out when the motion was made is really the question.
The motion was made before the statement that the contract was going to come back to us. We have the whole section of the minutes that I've pulled out. And part of the motion was on one page, and the second was carried over to another page. And then near the bottom of the carryover page, it says it's going to come back to us. And I don't think I have concerns about the contract. I just think that it's appropriate for us to see it before we proceed with it.
I can look at it on second reading, and the majority can also decide whether the contract is. If the council is having a problem with the contract, you can always make a motion then to separately approve it or amend it or something else like that. But let's agree on this. Let's just attach the contract to the back of the second reading. Unless the council directs otherwise, then we're going forward with the contract if the ordinance is approved. I like that. I like to see it go forward. But around there, doesn't mean exactly. All right, if someone else wants to make this motion.
I'm just going to be asking section 9-1-12, the little piece of the code. You need to be inserted in the red light plan as a certain instance in order to do that violation in section 603. The model profit code in Colorado be approved on first reading, and the public hearing be set for July 7th, 2009.
It's been moved and seconded to approve on first reading the ordinance changing or enacting section to allow red light to go. Discussion? Consider to vote. Do you vote with 6 in favor? With Councilman Clark voting no, the motion is approved.
But we're required to have policies as this in A and B here, one of which, the second of which is a policy enforcing applicable state and local laws against physically buying entrance to or exit from a facility or location, which would be subject of such nonviolent civil rights demonstrations within its jurisdiction. And they sent me a copy of two police department policies that relate to these items. But the one that relates to civil disturbances,
civil rights demonstrations.
civil disturbances, refers only to facilities, and that took place in, let's say, the local spaces around Atlanta. A location that's not a facility, it is not covered as necessary in that policy.
That's true, but this is, I remember this from when we had this little resolution saying that we had this policy because Housing and Urban Development required this. I had your exact same question. They provided the policy, and the reason why this statement is in here is this is one of the pieces of language that HUD requires to be approved by the local entity before HUD will do dollars. And that's one of the reasons that one of the changes that they're making to the generalized intergovernmental agreement. So it does pertain specifically to facilities, specifically housing facilities that are done with HUD dollars. Now, the policy that you're talking about complies with the HUD requirements. We need a desire as a council to expand that policy to other entities, but for this intergovernmental agreement, the reason why that language is in there is because of HUD, and that was what, a year ago when it opened? So I don't know if that answers your question.
Not exactly, because if I'm reading this presentation correctly, we have to have a policy that affects not just civil disturbances at facilities, but also locations. And it seems to be a minor tweaking, and I wouldn't want to hold this up for that, but I think that we ought to tweak that, that policy. That's the police department.
That's the police department policy.
So the issue isn't just this, what is what we need to have the idea. It's a collateral issue.
Okay, but the meaning is saying, it is saying if you have a force, if you have a policy against you, it is such a
force.
B is saying that you have a policy that says that you will keep open access points or entry points to facility will avoid this.
Okay. And we have a policy that relates, I think, to facility, but not to location. So if there's the demonstration, civil rights demonstration on property, not a facility, a location, because both of us are in it.
Well,
so it's in the
law, we have an ordinance that limits demonstrations and where they can happen and provide access.
I have it right here.
The ordinance or the policy?
Oh, I'm sorry, I have a policy.
Yeah, so you have an ordinance that, you know, with the, Right. Because we have an ordinance already that prohibits demonstrations in residential areas and allows demonstrations in other areas, but prohibits the blocking of sidewalks and entryways through basically businesses, but I don't know that I can say clearly that that's the location whatsoever.
I'm just going to put the same to me when we submit to my question. Do we have things that cover this?
Okay.
So, when I received this, and we said by attorney, we look at that again.
I'd like to point out that
I believe he's spending $250,000 in the Northeast neighborhood for cement and sidewalk work. This is another $100,000 we're putting into the area in addition to the increased enforcement and inspections that are happening to the apartments up in that area. All of that is being directed into the Northeast area of the city because the city is concerned and investing money and trying to make sure that all areas of the city are nice and livable.
In addition to that, we recently approved a big $100,000 for some cash in the corner.
Thank you very much.
We also have the ongoing codes inspection of the various departments.
Yes, we do. Further discussion? Council ready to vote? Item 7-7, motion approved. Brings us to 9B, which is a new street closure for the Jordan Wild on Wilson Boulevard.
I would do a brief introduction and John Rackley is from the Stenberg family this year. If you have any questions, Stenberg is the event manager for the Stenberg who will be running this project. July 11th is the selected date for the Wild on Wilson Block Party. I've identified in the council communication that we want a net cost to the city of about $6,500. And early overtime and expenses for our department to assist in setting up and cleaning up of the project area on Main Street. Many merchants have either contributed money or support the project. Of course, there are some that have indicated that they would prefer it not be held, but they are not going to stand up and object to it. I also talked about this with the chamber a couple of weeks ago in May, and if you have any questions, the chamber president is talking about the right to respond on this one.
Any questions, Mr. Charlie, or Mr. Brown?
I have one. If the race starts at 4 and ends at 11, and the food closes at 4 and opens at 11, when is the setup?
Well, what is the deal? The first street on the forecast will allow the stages to be set up and for the vendors to come onto the street. The event is open to the public at 6 o'clock, but here this morning, please correct me. And it doesn't have to be 10 o'clock. And then the thing will have an artist come on the street with a big fruit. And we clean up. We'll bring in some equipment depending on how much stuff we have to collect. We open the street up. Our goal is to have it open up by 11 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
1 hour after the event has been completed.
Okay. And then a question that maybe somebody else needs to answer. Mr. Batten's letter to the merchants about encouraging them to keep their bills open. Is there any need for us to extend the permission time for keeping the food open? I thought we had in our approval of that summer ongoing event, there was a time limit for the booze.
I believe that was 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
So would we need to have some minor extension for this one day?
This is the same day as the Artisan Festival on Main Street that Cookie Cooper Details has organized with some other merchants. And the Artisans are set up in the morning and do their view next in the afternoon. And there is a requirement to stay until the closing of the Artisan Festival, the example of part of which they say we allow. If you wish to say we will permit extension of that time period beyond 4 o'clock, that might be appropriate, but not you can't require them, of course, to stay beyond that time period.
I don't know, but I mean, since they want to give them so much time, if they want to stay, it seems to me we need some.
Let's get in with the Wild on Littleton activity as well, so that you have to carry over those Littleton or Bender boots into the evening hours to take advantage of the Wild on Littleton Block Party crowd.
That might be an appropriate thing to do.
In your financial details, you mentioned in previous years, we will bill the chamber $2,500 for cleanup costs. Who's billing? Do they pay it?
There are 2 years we didn't bill them.
Okay, so if we bill them, they pay it?
Yes.
Okay.
Tell me that, Bill.
And that's part of our contribution for the bodies. If that's true, what would we have asked? We could make our costs $9,000. But the chamber, exists on dues, and as everybody knows in this town, we include it. We're having some difficulty with that. But it seems like at least in our entire town, instead of the police and fire and public service, possibly doing this, is make this perhaps a little more successful. And we're looking to continue growing this innovation. And I would move that we do not bill the chamber for the cleanup costs, we pay the entire cost of the police, fire, and public service. So the move in second year to not bill the chamber for $2,500 for cleanup costs. Is it discussion? The vote is 5 in favor, the Johnson House no, and Johnson and Britton voted no, the motion is approved. That brings us up to, well, we don't have any motion. Yeah, I want to take the time to thank John Batman and South Metro Chamber of Commerce and listening to the downtown users that are listed here for putting the song in this year. I think it's wonderful. And he's been on a job and all that coming out real good. I'm doing very quick something to see we're kind of close to the issue. I'm going to move from my party to my 11th and 3rd.
Second. I'm going to move and second it to approve the request for the closing of the street as well. I'm going to block party and second.
I do have a question. How much of the merchants in the city feels realistic are to contribute to this?
How much? $6,000 so far.
Okay, but it was really sad and really, $6,000. But it was merchants and citizens, and the same citizens, and it was merchants.
Yeah, first of all, not even that. Okay. Further discussion? I'm for the vote. Vote in favor of the motion to approve. Okay, which brings us to item 9C. Which is a discussion on funding for historic preservation video. So, I'm going to have this presentation.
That sounds good. Before I was writing down that vote.
Oh, sorry. 9C. Funding for historic preservation video. Well, do you want me to put this on the agenda?
Yeah, but Bill's where I thought we were going to speak to this.
Yes. Oh, you are here. Sorry. I'm on the circle right here. We have this council communication that addresses this request for funding for a video. We are two very good forums, and one in February, one in March, and the intent of those is to reach out to the community and figure out what people really want to see. We had very good turnouts, as you know, and we're going to have our third one tomorrow night. It's 10 o'clock here in the community room to pair all those together. One thing that came out is a lot of people support preservation. A lot of people don't know a whole lot about it. They don't understand what the programs are, what's available to them, what our historic assets are and such. So what we have to do is to continue the outreach is to produce a 15-minute video or 15 minutes worth of video that would be in the office, and this is one large segment, which would be determined. in order to put that on talent. And that's, as you know, different programs that we have. What a state is, what it is, what it isn't, what our assets are. And so that's kind of a third note on this, and then we can really ask some questions.
I did know last year if you had a preference for when you would like the video started because the bigger options
sure.
At different times.
And we just kind of December, January's first available slot, I think it is. And as soon as we're all excited and older, then we really aren't, it's not time sensitive by any means. We'd like to get it sooner rather than later, as I say, but we. The first counseling when Tony is available and whatever the schedule is there.
So, if I'm currently low on option 3, find another source of revenue to pay for the program in 2009, if we didn't make it as one of the 15-minute blocks, but proceed various counsel on other meetings, mm-hmm. So I'm not going to carry this. It could be shown this year, could it get done this year and shown at other times? Well, we'll figure that still be lately, but we're excited that we really worked hard on it. Anything we want to be found in the home. As a matter of fact, we are area show right now, but we did, you know, probably in 2002 or 2003, like a 30-minute documentary style show that we did on historic preservation. And it's called Little Things from Agriculture and Technology. And it does include a lot of historic photographs and interviews with people who've been around for a long time. We did win quite a few awards. I'm not going to be able to do this.
I move City Council funds to start preservation video from the following four Littleton Show for December, January. We have very specific issues related to historic preservation that exist in Littleton that came before the council when Ray Acres submitted the building and released all records at the end of the property. A year ago, January, we had a workshop where we decided that one of our priority items was to meet with the Historic Preservation Board and try and work out some of the issues like consensual and non-consensual designation, any criteria that would apply or not apply to buildings like Rick's, and the parking as an incentive for that, and how you use parking as an incentive to get buildings into a historic preservation district that you then tear down the building and replace it with a new building. And Bill called and said that the Historic Preservation Board was setting up a series of public forums which they're not complete with yet. And after we held off the discussion, which I was perfectly okay with, but we're now down to the last of those meetings. We still haven't addressed any of those issues. He put up a generic video that talks about historic preservation in general that doesn't talk about what's happened in Littleton or what some of the specific issues are that we're facing in downtown. I think we're doing a disservice to the citizens because somebody has to address these questions. Otherwise, we're going to continue to have applications such as retail electric come in. There's going to be votes on a council for and against. There's going to be confusion in the public on what's going to be brought in and not brought in. And I think we still need to address questions like, are we talking about historic preservation district downtown, or are we talking about architectural control district? Who would control over the design guidelines? Should that be the planning commission or the historic preservation district? We want to continue to have parking as an incentive to get buildings into the district when, in fact, those parking incentives are being used to control guidelines, not to actually preserve buildings. And then, I have an issue on how you enforce historic preservation conformance on something like Beta Park, which has been brought into the district. So, I think that that would be a good service if we simply show generic things on what a district is or how historic preservation is happening in Littleton and not talk about the consensual versus non-consensual issue that has been controversial in Littleton. The fact that we have non-consensual which then requires you to have criteria, and that criteria then, in my viewpoint, prevents you from bringing in a building like Rick Acres into a district. On the other hand, if you want to come into a district voluntarily, then who are we to say no? And the answer is because of the criteria. I think there's a number of issues that we need to address, and simply putting up a basically a commercial for historic preservation doesn't do us any closer to solving those issues. So I'm hoping that some of that will happen on July which is tomorrow, 7 o'clock, interview, right? Okay. So I'm not in favor of doing a video based on what's been discussed up to this time, because in the pre-meetings that we've had, we haven't tackled any of those issues. And I think those are some issues that we even need to take care of, or here's examples on future submissions to the historic district are going to have the exact same problems that we have, and pretending that they're not problems or not discussing them isn't going to help. So that's my feeling.
On the first page of the council communication, there are
urban bullets, chief of urban bullets, factors that might be in certain things that might be in such a video. I see four of them that really are pretty neutral. Overview of Littleton history from the city's beginnings as an agricultural community to a small town to the vibrant city it is today. Preservation of historic resources such as the courthouse and the forest building on Main Street. Preservation of Alaskan Street and Main Street Historic District and other landmarks. Current projects such as Venus House Restoration and Main Street, maybe not the grant programs, but the restoration of Venus House. Those things seem to be informational, trying to help citizens and potential citizens, or anybody else who might see the TV, the broadcast, wherever they see it. But that helps people understand the history of Littleton.
Well, the faithful does. And thousands are the one about the Venus House restoration. But the second point is actually the crux of the problem. And that is, what is a historic resource? How do you define a historic resource? I mean, that was the exact issue with the regulator's building. Is, what is that historic resource, and does it need to be a historic resource to get into the district?
Since Andy is not here, and the one that I believe put the list together, I was reading that more as we need the courthouse as one of the bookends of Main Street, and the video will be featuring the courthouse, which is a historic part of Littleton's history going way back, and something that's now being used. So maybe people could say, well, okay, we like these and these.
I think the production right now has a preservation video, which is good. For one thing, that people bring attention to the very things that you're asking about. And might elicit more energy response to your questions if people have an idea about what's been going on in the past.
That's my concern is that we do a video and we end up not talking about any of the controversial things, and all we have in there is the courthouse and the court building, which are basically non-controversial. Because everybody can agree we're historic structures that are worth preserving, that basically are still going to historic preservation. That's not the problem that we face. The problem that we face is when you get off of the big ticket items that everybody recognizes and you get to the nebulous area. And what's really the difficulty is how you implement historic preservation, and specifically, how you can implement that in Littleton. And my concern is this showing a generic one that talks about the historic access doesn't get you anywhere. The vast majority of people in the city of Littleton, I think, are in general in favor of historic preservation. The devil's in the detail, and that is, how do you define the historic building? What is it that you want to preserve? The house on Cambridge Farm is an excellent example where we started off thinking we wanted to preserve that, and then we couldn't define this part, this aspect of the architecture of historical worthy to preserve. So, if we want to have a field good piece, then this could be the field good piece. Or, you know, just the architecture. That building is one of the oldest buildings in Italy. I mean, forget the architecture. It's one of the oldest buildings that, the only remaining real farmland in the city. And so, regardless of whether or not it qualifies, I don't think that's the purpose of the video. The purpose of the video is to tell a little bit about our history of Littleton and how we're working and striving to preserve that history. So, I mean,
favor
the motion. Yeah. That is. from kind of a logistical perspective, like I said, we've got a program on the right now, 30 minutes long, and so it's 4 or 5 years old, but we now have some of the details of, you know, grid and stuff like that, but I think that John's names when we're talking about Mr. Hilton, about a lot of the politics today that we're working with, there's 30 minutes up there right now. Also, I think that, you know, the Historic Preservation Board is one of a number of local commissions the city has. And I think that, I serve on, as used to do a number of these boards and commissions, it would be very hard to deny a 15-minute program to any of them. They all have stories of what's going on in the self-help working group, homeless in the museum, library. I think 15 minutes of a videographer running through any of these would be welcome for all of these entities. And so, we don't have that kind of budget at this point. I think that what I was putting together is 15-minute programs where there are 4 stories, and I think we included the one with historic preservation, too, which is called Historic Preservation. And you took a list of what she's got planned for production, and is it going to Lightner Court for, And that gives everybody an opportunity to get participating, and it's not one entity getting a full 15 minutes. But I don't support devoting an entire 15-minute December January program to the HPB. I support promoting HPB, I support the grit and the video looking from that and putting that at some point. I think they'll come and they could take some of the tapes or video that we've got and piece it together and include it in it. And so, some of that not doing it, it's just about not doing it one exclusive show. There's only 5 times or 6 shows a year, and so people take us 3 years to get all our board meetings up there. It's going to be hard to, if we don't this happen, how do we not let others do it there? So I'm not going to support this motion, but I would support an alternative for another source of revenue to go for the program, which if in fact I don't even know if that would be, if that would be some sort of fundraising done by HPB or something like that.
Tell me about all the programs that have been produced so far.
We covered the 2 HPB forms. We did one before the first form to promote both of them, and then we did one on the map where we interviewed Nathan Richards. So we did 2 on the 2 red forms. We did the open house that's on right now, the painters and open house is on. We did one on the water sign with the mayor. We did one on the police building. We did the dancing singing verse at Dean's Library. But now we've got one on the red exhibit at the museum. National Night Out, which is the wrong one. But, with 4 segments every other month, it's a part of, probably the most important thing. The next one we're going to probably run a reading event. I'll just talk to my head, let's talk about the best of the week.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm very much sorry. I'll see you.
Most of all, this is the fact that we have had this on our here not for such a year. We haven't hit a head on it, if we should have. We haven't heard too much about even the driveway in the very near future, but we want to be just setting it on a study session. And I would like to say that we can have controversial issues with the Historical Preservation Board with some of the business people. It is something that we have to dig into and see what we're going to come up with as far as the constitutional monarchy is concerned. Most people don't realize that there is a monarchy concerned with the central. The historic preservation ordinance has for or not situation. It can either be or it can be not. However, the Historical Preservation Board has recommended a section where team members can go out and declare something that can be put on to a list of merit. And we get quite a proceed on what the most important is after you get to that point, if it's going to be a requirement for those people to put on the preservation orders, that the first people sometimes have invited an option as to whether they want to be on it or not on it. It's just the idea that two people or the three members can go out and say, that's it. Oh, you can out there. Let's put it on the list of merit. So there are a lot of issues that we have to look at. And I think it's premature that we put out a film right now. And I certainly hope this council will be like this until we get through this in July. We have to get some action taken on this. And I thought it would be well before now. We've just got our patience. And I don't know where this is going to end up. But there is a lot of dissension on both sides, not on both sides, but against it. When you get into the historical board, you lose a lot of your rights that you have as far as what you can do with the facility. And that's why they had an opt-in, opt-out situation. But I think there's a paragraph in there to refer to. If you look into it, it's not that easy. So I think we should, if you're opting out of this, then we should do a permanent opt out. And that's about it. I want to see it started. And I want to see it under this council and some revisions made on it, if possible.
First, I'm ready to vote. The motion is to. Some of the preservation video from the Lutheran show for the January December.
I want to win.
Okay.
I'd like it to focus, and then the motion focus on the overview of Littleton's history from its beginnings as a center to the vibrant community it is today.
Okay, so move to. Focus the video on the overview of Littleton history from the city's beginning as an agricultural community to a small town to the vibrant city it is today. Is there a second for that? Okay, that dies for lack of second. So back to the main motion, which is to fund the preservation video from the Littleton Hill for just members of the board. Vote is 4 in favor with Councilman Fry, Councilman Brayton, and Councilman Trujillo voting no. The motion is approved 4-3.
Okay. And that brings the 09E. D. 09E. My understanding is that we may want to do 9B in executive session.
I think it will bring up issues related to legal advice and possibly the council and start negotiations at that point. Develop strategies.
And do 9E first before we work?
Yeah, I'm just trying to think this evening. Let's get a motion to table 9B until after reports.
Make a motion to table item 9B until the reports.
I guess we can move the second to table 9B until after reports.
So if we're looking at maybe the second of the education models, we need Greece and Hydro, Exploit, and RGC, and they will take the door into the closing session and get our legal advice and instruct the negotiations on the day. It actually relates as opposed to coming back and trying to do something.
I'm not sure we're going to take any action at all, but if we do this after reports, then I would suggest that we not take any action that would require a vote because that would be a reconvening here and we'll be staying very late. And we have another executive session. Sorry, we have a board appraisal that we're going to do this morning and not be an executive session ultimately. So the motion is to table 9B until after reports. Further discussion on the table. For the vote. Vote 7 favor, vote approved. Brings us to 9E.
Mr. Mayor, also, do we want to do tonight or on our next meeting be allowing the booths and Rising Littleton to remain open longer? Is that a simple thing we might do?
I want to try that during the comments.
Mm-hmm.
I want to try that during the comments.
Okay.
The motion is not comments. Okay. So we're 9E, which is the pipeline discussion. I believe we'll get on the council on coal. This council on coal had sent me an email late last week or late, whatever. Last week or something. And the question that I was asked for the case background, what I advised her was that, and due to, if I recall, but I can't remember, I think it was early last year, that she came in and I came to you and had requested permission. I'll just refresh your memory. The pipeline hiring was permission for us to at times exceed the authorized strength of the department. And she went into a discussion about the recruiting time and the fact that we had enough turnover and that we thought we could stay within the budget. Council, if you remember, you had quite a bit of discussion about that. Authorized gave us permission to do that with the assurance that she put in line and the commanders would monitor that budget, and we thought we would be certainly always within budget. And referring to Councilman Powell, a couple months ago, given what we anticipated to be a difficult 2010 budget process, we suspended the pipeline fire. And so the idea was that we didn't want to have people in the pipeline ready, thinking that they were going to be hired, and then we get into the 2010 budget in a few months, and we don't have the money. So we have to turn around and let somebody go. So, and then Councilman Perry also inquired about a resignation. We have an officer who's resigned to pursue some other career interests. And at this point in time, we're going to recruit for that position.
that it takes about 9 to 120 days to recruit, but we will not fill that position until we've assessed the 2020 budget process and what we're going to recommend to the city council. So, Councilman Cole felt like that. He wanted to have that discussed on record tonight with the council. That's where we're all at. It's presented to the manager, implemented by Chief Cruden and myself. If you have questions, I'm happy to respond.
The question? Hi, this is your course. Thank you for your name. The first council, I've got to add it in talking with the mayor. Your study session next week, my mid-year review, so you'll see that on the study session list when it comes out. And the point is that, so you're not surprised about that. I have some feedback from you. If you have given us an assignment to look at putting together a proposal, a scope of services to look at, we facility option one, city east onto this building. I've met with the design team and we probably are ready to bring some to you. However, the next open date is going to be July 14th. And we had already committed that night to having the sewer districts come and make a presentation on it. Soon that's going to be a fairly lengthy presentation. So I just wanted to give you a heads up. Either I can come back to you on July 14th with a proposal for a scope of services that we'll be moving ahead with this facility. It may run kind of late on the 14th, or you're off right now on July 10th, I'm going to say June 23rd and June 30th. I have no idea whether you want to work either of those nights, but if not, then it will be July 14th. Are the sewer districts going to have the rate study for us by June 14th?
Yes.
Because we said we wanted it enough before we had the. Then I don't think we're going to wait July 14th for the sewer districts. If we want some time to read that rate study before we get there.
Okay. I'll plan right now on scheduling the presentation to you on the, call the East Austin. It's just going to be done July 14th.
Okay. Do you have any idea when we're going to have the rate study done?
Scheduled a meeting with a consultant and a business on June 24th.
Okay.
And that's probably the first time we will see it. And then they want to get it to us so that if it's in front of council for that type of meeting or the city session in July, if you delay that because you need more time to review it, it would be then a session in August.
Yes, August 11th. 11th to the 25th. So you have it done June 24th?
We will be getting it from the consultant and having a meeting on the 24th.
Okay. So if we get it on the 24th and 25th, then we can do August 11th for the.
Yeah, if we're going to post that data, we can put it into a council packet that's ready for final presentation.
Okay. So if there's no objection, let's do the options for the people around the. We'll plan on that later.
Okay, thank you.
That's all I have. Thank you for your time.
Just to say that this Thursday, June 4th at 6 o'clock, we're having a council candidate forum, and it'll be myself, Wendy Wolfner, and John Austin Miller are going to speak. Wendy is going to take care of all the procedural things, the forms, and those kinds of things that you need to know when we're running. I'll be talking about the Fair Campaign Practice Act, the working hearing, and I'll talk a little about the general form of Wilson's government. And council member Austin Miller will talk about the duties of council member, things like typical time obligations, and what to expect. So this is a forum essentially for people who are thinking about running, give them a little bit more information. We anticipate we'll have another forum in August talking more about campaign finance practices for those candidates that I declared.
County, not back there in LA.
No.
Probably not. Alright, anything else? Pass along the call.
Can I have a promotion? Probably, can we get this, not on the, on the screen? And do you have a little, blurb of your pastor, please? Maybe you could do that out loud while we, do you mind, is that okay? I was talked to by the attorney when Kirkley entered in a traffic accident in a 5200 block of South Jennifer Drive. This is the house that drove from Steve's northbound and into South Barney's in Jennifer, striking the man's car, and a home was driven by Eva Mondragon. The man said a Mondragon was dead. The man held a press conference Tuesday, May 19th, in the room to the Center Community Room, 2255 West Bay Avenue, to discuss the accident and the injuries with the first person responders for health care. Three people in the accident who ran across the LPN test and graduated at the top of the class. Despite the significant injuries, numerous surgeries, and rehabilitation, she did not put her dream of becoming a nurse on hold. She took her state making board test in November and passed with flying colors. Colors. She was facing considerable medical bills. The donation is keeping me with an annual spend in part of the Calibrand Donation Fund. If somebody wants more information or wants a copy of this benefit analyst, I think they can contact me or I can maybe try. So, on the emphasis, next Monday night will be a benefit that we're competing with the last one. And then also people can donate to USAID. And Kelly has a tremendous amount of medical therapy to go through yet. We don't know any idea how much, but that will incur more significant more costs. So we're trying to get more down on this. Thank you.
Kelly, did anyone ever personal information on what happened to the driver in the state? How that happened, question brought up to me that they didn't call to the trial or they went to jail or anything for her.
Well, he was killed in that state.
He was killed.
And the police conducted an investigation and they finally could not determine the cause of the accident. They could not determine why he crossed over instead of other ways back. So, I don't know. Presented at the planning commission meeting that the Republic at Hudson Garden a couple weeks ago. It had quite a few people saying, boy, if we first had parking meters that were allowed us to park for 4 hours instead of 10, we'd have time not only to shop, but also to eat or vice versa. But people find it very difficult to walk from one end of the road to the other, leisurely shopping and also eating. So I would request that we have, I don't think it's a very time consuming discussion on this, but a study session, the issue of whether or not to increase those meters to 3 hours. That would, I think, relieve some of the issues with people saying that, you know, they can't park and get as much money as they'd like to spend. haven't requested a study session. Our next committee packet was quite long, and people are being encouraged to study people at Range Rovers so they can get out to do other things. After speaking with doctors who were on our faces to try to become familiar with what's on our agenda, so I'd like to talk a little bit about whether or not we really have enough time to study things given the delivery time of what's in our packets. So whether we need a few more days or some other day, I think we need to discuss getting more time, because if there's an issue that we want to follow up on, at least that I do, trying to follow up on things that we get through tonight, I'm trying to get the stuff heads up on questions we'd like answers. It's a little challenging, particularly with tonight's stuff. So, I'd like to add that.
You
want
to be able to say anything about it?
Yeah, I don't think it's a long one.
Okay.
And then the issue about extending the time that booths can remain open at Wild and Wilton, I would move that we extend the time they can stay open until 9 p.m. on the day of
So it's kind of like if you're ready to go, you know you're going to do something, you know,
in Denver, the largest food service distributor left in Mount Mason, distributed a $90,000 tax assessment on this strike room. So what happens if this issue indeed, if they have to pay this, all they do is they pass it on to every business that buys firearms. That'd be anywhere they have to go. And it's just another one of those tax assessments that was funded. And keep it away because that's been used in food without oil. You can really get things done. They claim to have taken a spin off of that business meeting. They're getting right down to the gut. We're pretty soon they're going to just have to get a knife and fight in there and see what the deal is for the day and just talk the hell out of it. That's it. Coming to as far as I'm concerned.
It's a safe to say that they're going to try it.
But, you know, these kind of taxes, what happens is they start one city and then next week they say, hey, that's pretty good deal, eh? Taking it up, but keep on going. That's how these taxes keep coming in. And eventually you have a whole bunch of small taxes that are being imposed on the people. The other one is, I've been wondering, where is the tobacco money? And this is one, you know, the big sheet from the tobacco companies that we see and have to pay out a lot. And I was reading here about where all this money went. And the state's first tax was for $32.8 million arrived in 1439. And this was for 5 years of 50 billion, a total of about 103.6 million, something like that. It's a total of 35.8 million over 5 years. And what has happened to this money is a lot of it has, for example, the state needs the feed program, which funds later the feed program for elementary school students, and they received 87.2 million. From the federal government. Another 13.6 million has gone to the Tony Gamble Food Services Program, which local efforts to reduce youth violence. But the largest single chunk of money for the state of 130.7 million was used to plug holes in the state budget over 3 years, going straight into Colorado's general fund. And from that point, it increased business growth in the general fund to make up the deficit that they have. So, what happens with all of these changes that are taking place? It seems to me that the net effect is funding to help people that have tobacco problems, lung problems. That's one by the roadside, and so you've got a windfall, and here it comes, and we take it out, we use it in the general fund, the same way that the federal government has used Social Security, and then other funds that they've been dissolved into. And I can see, can you go out of the voice that the state was trying to get $500 million from? That failed. And they left the gas fund, it's a state small fund, it has a total of about $2 billion in reserves. And this has proved to me a whole lot of small businesses and big businesses that these guys were raising the damn system because our premium would not have been that high. Now, if they got this much money in there, in a short time to get it, maybe they were unsuccessful. What we're saying to the people that I talk to is they say, well, you've got all this money in there, and why do you continue to pay the high premium? And I don't have an answer for it other than the fact that it's been a company that's just sitting out there doing the same thing, and nobody paid attention to it. didn't have any overseas in it. So, I hope that maybe, you know, that the people know that there's so much money there. Maybe the business people get afraid. I don't know if they will or not. They just sent out refunds. So they refunded money to every state in the country. And what did we receive from actually tobacco sales?
Our
tobacco sales and state received about $260 million.
About we were $300,000.
I've been going through a number of youth programs, and the legislature this year did in fact divert some of that money into the general fund. So but we don't get directly any of this settlement money here. It's all the cigarette taxes for everybody.
The cigarette taxes increased in 2004 by Colorado voters from 3 cents to 84 cents.
So, I think probably most global governments don't really want people to stop smoking. It's because people have an alcoholic problem. You can't take it away from them. But if you're willing to, you pick up this amount of money and you don't put money back into programs that are going to help these people, it seems to me that it's been improper abuse, and most of the officials that are taking care of these funds have not really taken care of it the way they should have. So, that's a lot of money that gets being passed around, and I think that's supposed to be a 5-year payout for approximately $103.6 million. Another thing we're going to be getting on the budget here pretty soon, and I'm just wondering if it might be a good idea. There's a lot of people in town that are legal figures, et cetera. I thought, if they could give a little input into the budget. They thought that'd be a good idea, but that's most generally the council works with it. But it might be, if people wanted to attend these meetings, I said, you're welcome to come down to whenever we work these things in our sessions.
So I just want to point out that the proposed line item budget is released, a couple weeks before council goes over there. And then it's available to the public. They can come down and get copies for free from the finance department. If they want to participate in the budget process, then I think we all encourage them to do so. Just go ahead.
John?
Tom?
The memorial ceremonies on Memorial Day was very well attended. We got some good groups and got some good publicity on it from the media. But it brought up to me again that Sally isn't working with doing what it costs to fix those books over there. I recently joined American Legion, and I found if I had a cost in mind, that's the Legion, the VFW, and the service club, and the city group doing about fixing those books that I would have worked in the morning. It gives you a chance to get an idea. I need a goal or how much money it might cost before I can talk to these people. We hope to find somebody to get the price money. They're fading and getting worse.
I guess just for the rest of us, and I'm not aware of this conversation, so just to re-inscribe all the bridges, the memorial bridges,
I think the bridge, the pagan, the bridge, the names on a lot of them. I thought he was going to look into it about a year ago. So. They might need just a good shredder.
What?
They might need just a real good shredder if people walk on them.
I don't know.
Your concern, Tom, is the names fading from the engraving.
Okay. I said, now we can bring that up, or if you have to take out the brick and start it over again.
Okay.
If we get something going on.
I remember when we had them, we had the vandalism. People put some paint on there.
Suddenly,
I think Loretta Donahue was able to find, some restoration service that was able to come and clean those bricks. But I don't know about the kind of re embossing. That's the first I've heard of this. So I don't know if there's a technique to do that or not. But
maybe it's going to be cleaned.
Why don't we do some research on that problem and see what we can come up with?
Yeah, we need a total goal of how much money it might take before we get out the service charge from the USW.
Let us provide some technical assistance in terms of what kind of products are out there, and then we can let more of what's possible. We may be able to, the restaurant suggestion is we need to do some research of the people who actually installed it. I'm just drawing a blank, it's been several years, so we can just find out.
Thank you. Yes, I want to congratulate Perry because he got the Main Street retail investment in the meeting that he does.
He got Brookfield Record Branding Construction got it. Branding Construction got it.
Nine, 12.
actually, I've heard when I was in the post office, there was a number of people that commented on how quick Main Street was on.
Well,
so congratulations to you and Brandon.
So, I want to make a motion about the Chicago Court.
Oops.
Anyone do you about the Chicago Court?
The 2035 Metro Vision Transportation Plan. The plan for changes to the urban growth boundary area for also asking for changes to that area in August, I think. And incorporate Southwest Rural County Metro Vision. We will approve amendments to the transportation improvement plan. We identify how surplus AFRA funds will be utilized. We adopted the 2009-2010 work program for FIMA. We will apply the amendment to the Articles Association. We approved comments we made before the Water Quality Control Commission meeting. The regulation of 38 inches along the excavator as well as the building. We again came to the governor to read the emergency health policy. We approved legislative wrap-up. There are several important briefings and informational items that we need to discuss. The Livable Community Subcommittee met the very next day. And we had a discussion on the results of the dwelling unit workshop. The presentation on occupational therapy and health system to universal design. And we discussed the recommendations back of the Land and Social Innovation Council.
Those are all the meetings.
Yeah. All right, John, you want to do because we're now doing 9B.
I move the City Council convene an executive session pursuant to CRS Section 246.402.4B and 4E to receive legal advice, develop strategies for negotiation, and direct negotiators regarding the Colorado Humane Society, followed by an executive session. All right. The second? Been moved and seconded to the City Council to go into executive session to give legal advice and develop strategies for negotiations and discussions. Ready to vote?
All in favor of the motion is approved.
Now we have City Attorney Review. I move the City Council convening an executive session pursuant to CRS Section 246.402.4F to discuss personnel matters related to the City Attorney's annual review.
I'll second. Okay. The move is seconded to go into executive session for City Attorney Review. Discussion on that. What are we going to do now in the executive session?
Vote. Vote 7-3, most approved. Okay, I believe we are supposed to say who goes into executive session. First executive session, I'm calling the Humane Society, the council, city manager, two attorneys, and a clerk. Real quick, please. I'm trying to figure out who will be the council and who's going to start. We are adjourning to executive session at 8:05 after. We will not conduct any official business afterwards.